episode number one of Painting for Fun with Chris. Yeah, I'm using a handheld smartphone to record this, but you know what? It works, so there you have it. So this is the first episode. These are a couple of paintings I've been working on for the last 4 or 5 days. They're from my Sea Beasties series of paintings or drawings or illustrations or whatever you want to call them. And they're about halfway finished when we start. And so that's where we're going to begin. And there'll be all kinds of other things coming up. There's going to be a lot of just sitting here and watching Chris paint and discuss what I'm doing. But I'll also have some technique lessons and some other things. One of the things I want to do is show you how to build picture frames that are really inexpensive. They cost maybe 3 or 4 euros a piece. And you can put your matted works in there. You can even build them for oil paintings. And they don't cost very much money and they look good. So I'll show you those in an upcoming episode at some point. So anyways, stay tuned. Enjoy the show. And please leave some comments. Subscribe if you like it. And get in touch with me if you'd like. Okay, so take care. Have a great day. Bye. Okay, so here we are.
Color's on there. Blackish color.
Okay. So anyways, this is one of the paintings I'm working on right now. This is from my Sea Beasties on Titan group of paintings or series or whatever you want to call it. And I started this thing last week. And when I started, it started out a lot like that. Simple line drawing. Then put in some basic wash, blue and yellow, and then build up over that. And nah, that's about all I've got. So anyways, I built up everything over the top of that. Yeah, so let's work on this a bit for a little while. I'll maybe make some comments while I'm doing it. If you have questions, put them in the comments. I'd love to answer them. Or thoughts. If you know somebody who makes music, I'd love to have some music as background here. But see, I can't just put on music because that's just really not legal. So I'm looking for some background music. So what I'm using here is a rigger brush. This is a Cosmotop number 2. I love Cosmotop brushes. These are really, really cool. If you're doing detail work, you need brushes that are fairly stiff. And Kolonskis, when I use them, they just don't seem to be as stiff to me as these Cosmotop spins, which are mostly acrylic. Not acrylic, there's some kind of artificial synthetic hair. I find they work really, really well for me. If you need to make straight lines like this, you gotta buy a rigger brush. There just isn't any substitute. There's no other way to do this. So yeah, we need some music. Somebody, call your friends. Find somebody who's a producer. What kind of music do I like? I like techno, ambient, electronic. Really, I like pretty much anything that's good. I think it was Duke Ellington once said there's two kinds of music. Good and bad. Don't play the second kind. That's good advice.
Yeah, so, like I said, this is not Bob Ross. I'm trying to do a lot of detail. Even on these surrealistic, illustrative type of paintings. And that just takes a lot more time. Really, I think that's the key to this whole project. Taking your time. I like doing paintings like this for one reason. They're kind of like, when somebody who's a needlepoint person or a crewel person, somebody who does needlework, it's when they make a sampler to show what they can do or to show different stitches. And I kind of see these little paintings a little bit like that. They're a good workout before I could do something that's like a more serious landscape. Well, I really like doing these. They are fun. Okay, the worms are in. Cool. Let's see, what do we work on next here? I have a need to do one of these sea beasties, so we'll start with one of those. What color is this one going to be? Let's pick a color. What? I think kind of a purpley color looks kind of cool today. I will say this, one of the things I like about painting this kind of a subject is you can never say that it's wrong. Okay, now we just need to spread this stuff out a little bit. So we'll start by just spreading the paint a little bit here and there. Come back in with a wash of just plain water, and that will make at least the first layer of sort of light and dark shadowy stuff. And remember, it's watercolor. The paint will dry a lot lighter than it looks when you put it down. That is the nature of watercolor. This is also a kind of rigger liner. It's a little bigger than the Cosmotops that I have, a little broader. And I use it a lot for filling stuff in. Lifting color and moving around. So that looks good to me. This 300-pound Arches paper, hot press. I like the hot press because you can just draw more detail on it. I'm not always the world's greatest sketcher or drawer, and hot press is good because it has a very flat surface and the pencil doesn't bounce up and down as you try to draw. Mostly I use Arches. Well, what have I got? I got Arches. I got Sanders Waterford in 200 and 300 pound. I've got some Jackson's Eco Press, which is a Jackson's is a European distributor of art supplies. And they make their own house brand. I think it's Gandhi Indian watercolor paper. It looks a lot like it. Condi, whatever it's called. I'll pull one of those out and work on it later. I got one that's halfway finished on something with that. What else do I have around? I got some Fabriano because I know where to get a cheap deal on Fabriano paper. And I'm thinking about increasing my supply, as it were. Got some Hananula, which I haven't broken into yet. Hopefully I'll do that later today. It's hard to get. Just not distributed very widely. 300 pound also. And then I have a couple of blocks of odd stuff like Moulin de Roy and some Centenary. Really, as long as it's cotton paper, that's what matters. I can say that the Fabriano is a little different the way it takes the water than Sanders or Arches. The Fabriano seems to be a little, even the 300 pounds seems to be a little weaker than the Arches or the Sanders Waterford, but on the other hand, the paint looks really good on it. It doesn't hold up quite as strongly to floods of water. So yeah, this is Germany where I live, and everybody here needs a winter hobby. Because right now, the weather outside is truly frightening. It's not the cold. The cold isn't that bad here. It's the wet. The endless pounding Nieselregen drizzle that just does not seem to stop no matter what you do. And it'll be like that until April. Really, it'll be like that beyond April. But after April, it's not so bad because when the temperature warms up, it's not as unpleasant. You see, we really need to get some more music in here of some kind. I like that red, man. It's a St. Petersburg alizarin crimson. White Knight, I guess is what they're called today. Right now I'm using mostly Sennelier and White Knight's watercolors for these projects. I also have a bunch of Rembrandts and Old Holland. Okay, I like that. Looks good. Let's do something else here. So if you're going to ask me what the Sea Beasties are about, the truth is, I can't tell you. I have no idea, man. Where did this... Sitting in a hostel over in Holland. Said, I want to draw something that's not like everything else. And so I started drawing a Sea Beastie. I said, that looks cool. I bet I could fill that in with some watercolor and it'll look really good. And so I did. And then I started making these things. That's the problem with this sometimes. Now I've got about 5 or 6 creatures in this world, and so what I'm thinking is I'll develop it as a whole series. I got some interesting ideas coming up. Some of it's going to be influenced by the Anasazi Indians out west. I was always interested in their history and anthropology. Some of it might be influenced by other things as well. One idea I had was I could put together a really interesting picture book, probably for children, but maybe also for adults, from these paintings. take a look at this. Okay, looks good. This one's getting closer and closer to actually being done. Probably can't see when I'm in my head over like that, can you? Well, too bad. Hopefully they're out there fixing my internet, which I doubt. They broke the internet here about a week ago. And the cable, and so nobody's got any cable or internet. It's pretty much like the Dark Ages again here. It's amazing how dependent we have become on technology. It really, really is. It's like people walking around with their smartphones everywhere. God, that drives me mad. People are so absorbed by their smartphones, they are not aware of what is happening immediately around them. I cannot believe that. And then people worry about things like, oh my God, there's terrorists out there that are going to blow me up. Well, you know, if you got earphones on, and you're bopping down the street ignoring everything that's going on around you. I just have a lot of problems giving a lot of sympathy for that. It's like, God. Okay. Now. Another thing I like about the hot press paper, you can load the paint up on here. And it'll come out looking really sort of super, super glazed looking. Really intense color. But you can still see through it because I use a lot of transparent colors. But you gotta let it dry for a while. And that's the next thing I'm gonna do is let this dry for a bit. Usually I like to paint for about 20-25 minutes, and then I take about a 5 or 10 minute break, and then I go back to it. Although sometimes I'll just sit here and paint for hours. Alright, that's looking good. I still got some eyes to put in. This is almost finished, really. I don't want to really overdo it. Okay, before I mess anything else up, we are now going to take a break. So, back in a few. So we're back after a short break. This is another Sea Beastie picture I'm working on.
about time to change some water here. Oh yeah, we should start over here. Start on the right and work to the left. Maybe someday I'll remember that. Or not. Some indigo with the black, so it's mostly this Mars black and kind of warm. It's jumping over the line there, that's unusual. This is Strathmore 300. No, it's not Strathmore 300, it's Sanders Waterford. Strathmore, that was the paper I used when I was younger. Back in architecture school, Strathmore 400 and 500. All the only good stuff was the 500. 400 was some kind of wood pulp paper, and wood pulp paper just doesn't cut it. I seem to have contaminated my indigo. Well, you know what? I kind of like this brown, so I'm going to work with it. Oh no, it's getting more indigo-y. Is that a word? Indigo-y? Indigo-y. Rooster is super quiet today. What's up with that? There's a rooster who lives in my backyard. Too cold for him to make a lot of noise today. Must be the problem. See, I like coming back in. Too worried about what I'm doing here. I'm just having fun, really. Questions. If you got questions, put up questions. Put them in the comments. I'll be happy to answer your questions. You may not get the answer you expect, but I'll be happy to answer them. Sure, you can ask questions about painting or anything else that intrigues you. But like I said, you may not get the answer you expect. Love this glazing technique. For me, that's one of the things that works. But then a lot of the artists I've tried to copy or study use that kind of technique. That's
actually really old technique when artists had to grind their own pigment and make their own paints. The pigments were expensive. They were usually rare gems that had to be ground up. And even though they weren't high quality, like for rings or things like that, they were still expensive. And so they developed techniques to paint that required very little color and got a lot of intensity. And if you want to learn more about that, I'd say get a book called How to Paint Your Own Vermeer. Good luck finding a copy. They're out of print. They're very expensive. But that book has all the techniques in it that the old masters use, or most of them. And it explains what they did with underpaintings and building up the layers and how they got the effect that they got. And it's all in there. Or just watch a bunch of YouTube videos. There's stuff on YouTube that explains how it's done. That's pretty common. It's almost a catastrophe. Yeah, they used a lot of glazing techniques, and I got used to painting like that. Even with watercolor. I find if you look long enough, somebody can do anything in watercolor that you can do in oils or acrylics, but it's usually not as easy. The other trick is, almost all the so-called classic watercolorist master types were using gouache or egg tempera to bring out the highlights. Now all the traditionalists will start screaming, no, no, that's not watercolor, blah, blah, blah. Well, frankly, I don't give a damn. It doesn't matter to me. I figure if it's good enough for somebody like William Turner or Peter DeWitt, it's probably a good enough technique for me to use it. Yeah, I do like that. That's kind of a nice brown. Sanders Waterford paper. This one will probably get finished today, that's cool. So yeah, they would use some kind of opaque white to bring out highlights. And not just to bring out highlights, they'd use it to cover whole entire areas and then paint over them a second or third time. All kinds of stuff like that. actually, that's one of the projects I want to do next, is get a tube of Sennelier egg tempera white and experiment with what I can do with that. Not just with watercolor, but also with oils, because I recently watched a video where a famous British painter was showing how Turner did his oil paintings, showing the famous painting of the boat sailing down the river. The old sailing ship is being towed away to be destroyed by the people who destroy old ships, and there's a ugly modern steam tug there dragging it off to die. And he was showing how somebody like Turner could use egg tempera in an oil painting to bring out highlights, or to paint whole areas and then glaze over them. And according to him, once the paint dries, there's no possible way to tell if it's egg tempera or oil without doing a chemical analysis, which sounds pretty logical. Using egg as the binder, well, that's some kind of oily kind of substance. And he just went amazingly fast with this painting when he was doing a copy of that thing. It was just whip it out overnight. So yeah, I'm gonna get some egg tempera and experiment with that. I think one of the reasons I like doing these paintings is because it's just so dark outside right now. You get about 6 hours of sunlight a day, if that. And it's nice to have something bright. Yeah, I like that. It's turned out nice. Alright, here's one of the secret advantages to mounting your paper on a board like this before you paint. If you do that and you're trying to do details like I was just trying to do, and you move your hand here, the paper and your hand, and like if you jerk something, everything's moving in the same direction. If I'm doing that on the ground and I jerk the paper, it won't be the same. So basically it prevents accidents. Alright, I think we're about ready to take a break on this one. Yeah, I almost feel like I'm ready to take a break on this one. I like to stop and think before I keep going. I like things to dry. It makes it a lot easier when stuff is not all wet. I don't have to think as much about where I put my hands and what I'm doing. And since I do a lot of glazing anyways, yeah, we'll take a break. This one's almost finished. It just has the creatures left. Okay, one Sea Beastie in. Yeah, we definitely need some music. If anybody knows a musician who writes interesting music to Pooh, tell them to send me some music. And I'll use it as background music. This is another nice thing about me doing your paper like this on a board. It makes it really easy to turn the picture around and work on it, and you don't have to touch the paint. That is always good. You have to be careful in this kind of mathematical mapping situation about what exactly is going on. This time I think I'll work real thin wash to something a little darker. chickens are out. I like these little sponges for this situation. You just soak up all the extra and pull it right off. There he is. He's out. Coming to the point where I need to stop. It is starting to look a little more three-dimensional, which is cool. But I think I'm ready for a longer break. I need to make some tea or coffee. And then maybe I'll come back and finish these up. That'll give them some time to dry. Yeah, doing detail work, well, it's just slower, man. If you're the kind of person who likes painting fast, then you need to use more of the Bob Ross wet and wet technique. Although that's not particularly his technique. He didn't invent it any more than I invented what I'm doing, or anybody else did. None of us did. That's the truth. Somebody stole it from somebody else. And it is true that watercolors are less forgiving than oils. That's another reason you might want to use oils to start with, or acrylic. But if you like the way watercolors look, well then, start painting with watercolor and learn. I actually started with oils when I was 7. I didn't really get into watercolors until I went to England and saw some of the classic watercolorists from Britain in the 1800s, 1700s. And at that point, I was completely hooked. It's not that hard to paint with watercolor. If you're starting out, I'd advise you to buy 90-pound, 100% cotton paper. Buy about 20 sheets, full-size sheets of this stuff, and plan on wasting all of it. You'll get some good pictures, no question, but don't worry about the cost. It'll cost you, you know, 40 euros, 30 euros, or something like that. Not a lot of money. Paint on that for a while, a couple of months, maybe less. Learn how it works, and then get the better quality paper. But don't waste your time painting on anything other than cotton paper. It's not worth the trouble. The water simply does not flow the same way. It doesn't soak into the page the same way. And you really can't develop watercolor technique on some some kind of paper that isn't designed for watercolor. Gouache, maybe, yeah. But then you got whites and stuff to paint over stuff, and then it's opaque, and then it's a whole different world again.
Not with watercolor. So, I think we'll take a break right there. I'll probably put these two together and throw them up. As I said, you kind of jumped right into the middle of a couple of paintings here. So, that's the way it works sometimes. So have a nice day and come back and see me later. Bye.